Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I am your host, Jason Turner, and I am available for code reviews and on-site training. This episode is an episode that was requested by a viewer, and they put it in the episode tracker, which there are links to in this video description if you want to be involved in that kind of thing, and I really liked this proposal. So I'm going to go ahead and cover this topic of what is the difference between apply and invoke, and why do we have both? Of course, before I continue, I do want to encourage you to check out links to upcoming events and such in the video description. This episode is sponsored by JetBrains. Today we need tools that help us work quickly and effectively. CLion is a powerful JetBrains IDE for C and C++ that makes filling this need its main goal, integrating code analysis, refactorings, and a wide range of tools into your day-to-day development. The latest version of CLion introduces deep integrations with the ReSharper C++ Writer C++ language engine, performance improvements for the debugger, new features for embedded development, and enhancements for project models and build tools. Use the code CPPWeeklyCLion to get 25% off when purchasing a new CLion subscription or renewing your existing one. Let's go ahead and start by pulling in the functional header. And let's give ourselves some sort of function to call. The function invoke is a standard library function in the functional header that lets you call any callable with a set of parameters. So I might be able to do something like this, and I am calling the add function with the left-hand side and the right-hand side. And you might ask, why would you want to do this? And the general answer is that you want to do this in generic code more often than in not generic code. But it also gives you a little bit of a handy way to call member functions, because member function pointer syntax is weird. And it also lets you call lambda functions. So as you can see in this example, I am calling invoke. The first thing that I'm passing it is a pointer to the add member. The second thing I'm passing it is a reference to an object of type S. And the third thing that I am passing to it is this parameter that I want to pass to that add member. And this kind of makes visible the fact that all of our member functions have a hidden first member, which is this pointer. Well, in this case, it's very explicit that that is what I need to do here. As you can see, this can be called with really anything that is callable. And that answer just gets dropped on the floor here because we're not doing anything with the result, but it does return the proper value back to us. So we can see move 12 into EAX, 3 times 4 is 12. That is what this code is doing. That is invoke, and I think that pretty well covers it. We have some sort of callable and then a list of parameters. Apply is very much the same concept, but it is intended for use with tuple-like things, things that have the get interface on them, where you can get to the individual elements of a tuple. So I might do something like this. I have the thing that I want to call, the callable, and then the set of parameters. But in the case of apply, all of these parameters must be packed into a tuple. Whereas with invoke, it is a variadic list of parameters. The same exact concepts apply, if you will, to both. So the question was, why do we have both in the standard library? And I think it's fair to say that the both have applications. There are sometimes reasons why it makes sense to pack your set of parameters into this tuple, or perhaps they were already given to you that way, perhaps as the elements of a standard map in a pair, which has the tuple interface to it, or it's just a convenience thing for how you want to pack these in. Maybe you have something like some sort of packed set of packed parameters Where if you did this with a user-defined struct that had an int and a float, then it becomes a little bit tedious to call a set of callable things on the set of parameters because you have to explicitly name these things when you could potentially just use standard apply. Now I'm going to give a brief example of how these things might look. And these are not exactly how it would be implemented in the standard library, but it is an illustration of how these things can look. Note I'm using decaltype auto, which tells the compiler to perfectly preserve the return type of this function call. I could use the decaltype of the result of calling this function with a set of parameters, but I'm choosing not to in this case. So this is pretty straightforward, but it only works with lambdas and free functions. This syntax cannot work with member functions because we have to do the goofy member function call syntax in that particular case. We could call the standard invoke, but that becomes a little bit circular here as far as the point of implementing this goes. So we would need some sort of helper in here to say, if this is a member function pointer, then I need to use member function pointer syntax. Or if this is a member variable, then I need to use member variable syntax with zero parameters. I believe you can do that with invoke as well. Now we're going to get into a little bit more TMP foo with a whole lot more ellipses than I tend to show on this channel. Note the same caveats apply here. What I am currently doing is only accepting things that can be invoked just like functions with the parens. This does not work on members. So I've declared the function. It takes any generic callable thing by value. That is how all the standard library functions that work with callables work. And then it takes by forwarding reference a tuple-like thing. Now I'm doing something that requires C++ 20s changes to lambdas. And I know I've said this a million times on this channel, but if you fully understand everything that lambdas can do, you understand a significant portion of the C++ core language. So this is the template parameter pack that is the set of indexes or indices. And this is the single parameter that this lambda takes. Now, note that it is implicitly capturing by reference, which some people will tell you not to do, but I am immediately invoking this lambda down here, which makes this lambda perfectly safe to have this implicit capture by reference. I need to call makeIndexSequence for something that is the tuple size of this tuple type that has had const volatile and reference removed from the type. So this thing is going to be a reference type of some type. It might be const, it might be an R value reference, it might be an L value reference. So I need to remove the ref, and I need to remove the const, and then I need to ask at compile time, what is the size of this thing? So however many elements were passed to me, 1, 2, 3, 4, whatever, it will then call makeIndexSequence for that. And this makeIndexSequence is going to return something that is a type generated by the standard library, probably with compiler intrinsic magic to make it faster to generate. That is of the type std indexSequence, and then the set of size t integers from 0 to n minus 1. So if this thing is a size of 0, then I will get an empty index sequence. If it is a size of 1, I will get just the value 0. This is indexes into a thing. So I needed to do that because now I need to be able to unpack at compile time the set of tuple elements that need to be passed to this function. Now at this point, it would probably be fair to just go ahead and call my own invoke, because it already knows how to do this hard work for me. And I'm going to pass to it this func, although probably fair to move that func to avoid another copy of it. And then I need to pass it the set of parameters. So I am going to do this variadic expansion. I'm saying get the current index. So it will expand first time get 0, get 1, get 2, get 3, etc. And then I want to pass to get the forwarded tuple that was passed to me. So if I was given an R value reference, I want to pass an R value reference into get so that I then also get an R value reference back out from that tuple. And then I'm going to do this variadic expansion right here, these three dots. And what we're going to get duplicated for us by the compiler is this chunk that is currently highlighted. This is the part that will become get 0, get 1, get 2, get 3, get 4, all automatically unfolded by the compiler at compile time. And now I can call my apply. That might look like this, and we'll comment out these other things so that they don't get in the way of our code. And as we can see, the compiler knows that I'm not returning or using the result of this trivial calculation at all. Therefore, it throws away all of my work. Go optimizer. But if I pass in 5 minus 4, then I'm going to get 1 returned from main. Or if I were to go back to this code that calls add without knowing what exactly the implementation of this add thing is, then we can see the compiler setting up a call to add that takes the values 4 and 5. 5 and 4, it sets the values up in the opposite order of the calling. Hopefully this made some sense. Like I said, this is far more ellipses than I tend to show on this YouTube channel. But maybe you enjoyed this kind of rather difficult to understand and read C++ template metaprogramming kind of code. And this is, again, where I make the distinction between template metaprogramming and constexpr. A lot of people still want to conflate constexpr with template metaprogramming. Constexpr is just regular code that happens to be executed at compile time. Template metaprogramming is code that must be done at compile time because we're asking the type system to do things for us and generate new code for us at compile time. Well, that's my random rant about that. All of this stuff works in the C++ 20 timeframe, so have fun with this. There are links to the examples in the video description, so check those out. Otherwise, be sure to subscribe, and I'll catch you in the next episode.